That was amazing. Thank you for sharing your stories. It's something I didn't know as a Yukoner. I'm very happy to hear about that. Also, Charlotte, I think you did really well speaking. I don't know what you were nervous about. The number one fear that people have before death is public speaking. So I think you did great. And I told you I'm coming back to the East Coast. I'm going to come visit you at Labrador. Can I stay with you? Okay. You're my witnesses. We're going to show one more video. I would really like to acknowledge and thank the video crews that have been working on the camera people and the team. They've done a wonderful job. What I like about the calls to gather is it's not possible to be at every single event, but you can at least see some of the things that are going on in other parts. During this next video, can Patrick Etherington Jr. come up to the stage to do your draw? So the next item, our final item of the evening, looks to the future by examining the road to reconciliation. The journey is not an easy one, and there are many challenges along the way. But if we travel this road together, we stand a better chance of succeeding and building a better future for all Canadians. You will notice that the circles open here. And we did that deliberately because we're including all of you. My name is Mandy Wesley. I'm Senior Advisor of Public Engagement with the Truth and Reconciliation Commission of Canada. And today I was moderating the Circle of Reconciliation. And what that is actually, it's an opportunity to bring together survivors as well as signatories to the Indian Residential School Settlement Agreement to talk about reconciliation.
Reconciliation to me is respect one another. That reconciliation has to come from the government and the churches, and when it comes from the heart, that's when it's going to mean something to all of us.
The path of reconciliation is a lengthy one, and the process requires much patience. Divisions developed over several generations, and which were so traumatic and painful, won't be resolved within a few years. A healing of memories is essential. The events of the past, which have been viewed in isolation, now need to be understood as part of a common history. The history of these schools was not one of liberation. They were part of a system that was racist and oppressive.
Physical, sexual, and emotional abuses that occurred at residential schools were among the most deplorable acts committed against any people at any time in Canada's history.
The theme that keeps jumping at me from this event is for the child taken and for the parent left behind. How do you reconcile with that? I had to deal with that personally with my mother. She was a residential school survivor also. I did ask her, why did you send me there? Why? When you knew what the nuns did to some of those kids. When you told me what the priest did to you. Why would you send me? And she said, Dost, I had to do it. The agent came, and I had to send you.
It is so important that we gather statements from other former students of residential schools in order to understand the impacts of individual survivors, families, and whole communities. Events like this are just part of a long journey of reconciliation.
I have a long, long way to go before I can fully and truly enter into and comprehend the experience, the feelings, the pain, and the hurt that I have touched and sensed here this day.
As we confront the legacy of the past, we also need to look with the understanding that reconciliation today requires significant change in the relationship between First Nations, government, and all people in Canada.
Our institution failed to recognize or challenge the forced assimilation of Aboriginal peoples and the subsequent loss of their language, culture, and traditions. That was a grave mistake. It is our responsibility. We are sorry.
It's important to the Aboriginal community to actually see that this dialogue isn't just one-sided, that they are part of this conversation, that they are committed to working towards reconciliation, that they be the government, the churches, that they do come and join this circle. It's integral to the integrity of the entire process.
A commitment to reconciliation is a commitment to take real action that will lead to change perceptions and attitudes. It's a commitment to the future. We are committed to furthering the reconciliation process in love, moving toward a future of healing and hope and right relationships for all.
There's two things. A relationship has to start from truth, and it has to carry on by walking together. Words without action aren't worth anything. So for me, part of reconciliation has been learning what actions to take and when to take them.
Reconciliation will happen to me, I believe, when I see my children studying their culture, studying our language, in ceremonies, talking their talk.
So I think a day of recognition for all survivors across Canada would be good. Pass these messages on to the people that are willing to listen.
So today we look at the truth, to talk about our shared history as a way to help us in the ongoing effort to turn the page in our dark history here together.
Reconciliation is the goal. It's a goal, and when it is achieved, it's going to make for a better, stronger Canada.
Hello. There we go. That was very beautiful. Thank you. You know, these videos that they do, they've done them from Winnipeg, from Inuvik, and now for these ones. And so it's a great way for people who don't get the opportunity to be lucky enough to be here. You can share it with your friends and your family back home. You just go to the website. I'm pretty sure it's the TRC website where